Everything was so different. I can close my eyes and see the campus the way it used to be.
Good morning, Barnard. I'm Rona Wilk, class of 1991 and the AABC Reunion Chair, and it is my pleasure to welcome you to the inaugural edition of Morningside Memories, Alumni Tell It Like It Was, a series of interviews with alumni from the 40s and 50s to learn about their Barnard experience in the years during and directly following World War II. We'll be releasing a new video every morning of Reunion Reimagined 2021. Today, we are speaking with Marjorie Lange from the class of 1950. Marjorie grew up on Long Island and majored in mathematics, and we are so pleased to have her with us today. Welcome.
Good morning.
So I'd like to just start out maybe with maybe the obvious question, but why did you choose Barnard?
Well, for one thing, my father didn't have much money, so I couldn't go to a college where I'd have to be boarded. So we just had to scrape together enough for the tuition. And my advisor, my senior high school advisor, advised that I would be a good candidate for Barnard, and she kind of steered us in that direction. So it was the only school that I applied to.
You came to Barnard right after the war had ended, correct?
1946.
And for the college, it was a time of transition as well, because Dean Gildersleeve would be retiring that year.
Yeah, we had her there for 1 year. Then in 47, McIntosh came in.
So do you remember anything about Virginia Gildersleeve or versus Mrs. McIntosh?
Oh, yeah, very much so. Gildersleeve was quite a presence. Everybody sort of hushed when she walked by. And she had the same kind of voice as Eleanor Roosevelt, who had a kind of a broken voice, not a broken voice, but a special. And I remember one time when one of my classmates was imitating her. We were sitting on the North Lawn, which was much bigger than it is now. Of course, it stretched from Claremont to Broadway. And Mary Ruth was sitting there giving an imitation of Gildersleeve saying, "Bonnet ladies." And Gildersleeve was walking down the path coming from Millbank Hall, and she was behind Mary Ruth, who couldn't see her, and we were saying, "No, be quiet, don't say anything." And she came and she walked by and she said, "Good morning, ladies." She was quite a presence, but as freshmen, we really didn't get to interact with her much at all. And she was very aloof, very academic. Mrs. McIntosh was much more down to earth, much closer to the students, much more sort of a mother figure in a way, which she was a mother.
So do you have a particular favorite memory of your college years?
I had several favorites. One, of course, was Greek games, which doesn't exist anymore as it was then. I mean, can you imagine, of course, you don't even have a gymnasium anymore, which is where the Greek games used to be. Can you imagine people running around with lighted torches in Barnard Hall running the torch race?
Fabulous.
You know, it's... I don't think the fire people would allow that now.
No, I didn't realize they were lit. That's
absolutely
slightly alarming.
In order to really get points, you had to cross the finish line with the thing still lighted, and you had to pass it to four or five people.
Wow.
Go around the arena that was built in the gym. And you got points taken off if your torch wasn't lighted at the end of the race. I loved Greek games. It gave us a chance to meet people in the class that we might not otherwise meet, because math students, there were 8 math majors, you know.
Now, did you ever leave the Oasis to go across the street to Columbia's campus?
I had some math classes over in Columbia, and boy, that was a run. You had 3 minutes between classes to get from Barnard all the way across the Columbia campus. We were always late for that class. we couldn't do anything about it. Even if we ran, we couldn't do anything about it. But that was the only class that I had on Columbia's soil.
Was there a social life between the two campuses, or
very much. A lot of my classmates wound up marrying Columbia men before they even graduated. There was a lot of social life between the two campuses, although they had the fraternities. We didn't have sororities, and there were no women, of course, at Columbia at that time, so it was all guys. But there was much to-ing and fro-ing between the campuses. And so I was a dorm student from my last year. I really needed to get away from my battling parents, and my advisor said, why don't you live in the dorm? Because normally, if you could commute, there was no room for you in the dorm.
Right.
And it would, you know, it wasn't even considered as a possibility, but they got me a room, which was the last room on the north end of Hewitt on the ground floor. And it was funny because I was in the Court of Senior Proctors being a class member, and I don't know if they have them anymore.
I don't think so. Can you explain a little what that entailed?
Well, when we had exams and the professors were not in the rooms, at exam time, it was honor system.
Right.
And so the Court of Senior Proctors were the proctors who would sit in the halls, like we'd sit in on each floor of Barnard Hall, where there were classrooms, or Milbank Hall, where there were classes. And if someone saw someone cheating, they were obliged to go tell the proctor, we saw somebody doing something they shouldn't be doing. And it was a sort of an in-house legal department, if you will. So here I was, a member of the Court of Senior Proctors, living in this first floor unit, dorm room. And early on in my residency there, like first week, I had several people who lived in Brooks who came to me and said, you know, sometimes when we come in after hours, we used to come in through your window. We just wanted to know if the arrangement was still there for us to do. And I said, well, considering the fact that I'm on the Court of Senior Proctors, I really don't think the window is going to be open for you anymore. To which the response was, forget we ever came here. You don't know us. Don't remember anything.
That's fantastic. Can you talk a little bit more about your dorm experience in terms of what going for, you know, having meals there?
The dining hall was down in the basement. I think it's still there.
Yep.
It was, we all swore that somebody was paying off the dorm in pork chops because we had pork so often for dinner that sometimes we ran away and went over to Amsterdam Avenue to the pizzeria over there and had pizza instead.
Did you actually have, especially when you were in the dorm, did you have dress codes for going off campus?
In those days, a young lady who, when she went traveling on the subway, would be wearing gloves, we were wearing stockings, we'd be wearing, you know, up what we call grown-up clothes. But I discovered that there was available to day students in the basement of Milbank Hall, there were lockers. And you could get a locker for the, you know, for the whole. So what I did was to keep a pair of jeans and a pair of saddle shoes and stuff in that locker. And when I got to Barnard, I would change into what was called the dorm clothes because I looked like the dorm students. And a lot of people thought that I was a dorm student because I wasn't wearing the stockings and the gloves and the hat and the whole thing. It was a dress code that was self-imposed, I would think. The subway station then was in the middle of the road. It came up on the in the median between the north and south lanes of Broadway. Now it's a much safer arrangement because you can get up on the sidewalk. You don't have to worry about getting across Broadway. The subway cost a nickel, believe it or not. The train was 35 cents. Wow. one day I got on the train and I realized I didn't have my money with me at all. There was a girl who lived in Little Neck in Bayside who used to see on the train every day, and I knew she went to Barnard because we were on the same trains all the time. So I approached her on the train and I said, listen, can you lend me a nickel for the subway? I won't have any way to get uptown. And from that, we became friends.
Fantastic.
Then we met each other every morning on the train, practically every morning. And so we became, in fact, with a bridesmaid at her wedding. I mean, you know, it was really a friendship just because I needed to borrow a nickel.
I love it. What was it to be a college student versus going off to work directly after high school?
Well, my high school, you had two paths in high school. One was the commercial path, where in high school you learned to type and steno and all of that. And then there was the college prep classes who took more of a liberal arts direction with math and history and English. And so there was a large proportion of people in my high school who were destined to go to college and who did. And I would say probably more like 2/3 to 3/4 of the students were aimed in that direction, and the other students were going to go to work after high school.
After college, did you have expectations of marriage, going to work, combining both?
You know, it was funny. I had no expectations at all. As a matter of fact, I didn't know who in the world would employ me for money after I did. So I didn't have any particular objective in mind when I went to Barnard. Like, I'm going to be a this or that or the other. I was just going to be a math major and see where it took me. And so I thought, well, now, how in the world is anybody ever going to pay me money to do anything? What am I employable as? And not that I shirked the question, but I did have family in France. My first cousin and my mother's sister were over there. And my father's brother, my uncle Arthur, and his wife decided to give me a graduation present of a trip to France.
Wow.
And so I cooled my heels that first summer in Normandy with my cousin. While everybody else was getting jobs, I was doing nothing but having fun.
That's amazing. And not long after the invasion, I mean, what, 5 years after?
This was 1950. And when I was in Caen, which is in the north of France. And I can remember going through that city and it was a wreck. I mean, it was still rubble. There were people living in apartment houses in an apartment that had three walls and the fourth wall looked out on the street. You know, it was a disaster, and the whole area was a disaster. There were still wrecks of wartime landing craft out in the water. And there was this ship that had sunk out there with a great big hole in the side that had been blown out of the water, but it was still sitting there. And people were using it as a fishing dock. They'd take their boat out there, go into the hole on the side of the hull, tie it up to a ladder inside the ship, climb up that ladder inside the ship and get up to the deck where they used their fishing. So we did that too. It was a great adventure.
Wow.
How did I get on this? Oh, well, so then when I came back from France, I decided I better come home and do something to justify my existence. As my father used to say, what have you done today to justify your existence? So I came home. It was November. Everybody else was working. I went up to the placement office at Barnard and said, well, here I am. Find me a job. And they did, as a statistical clerk in a little company down off 42nd Street. And that's where I started, as a statistical clerk running a Marchand calculator and doing multiple correlations. Boring.
Do you have any memories of going to reunions after graduating?
I went to every reunion going from the first one. I went to every reunion. I loved reunion. I missed it terribly last year. Yeah. It would have been our 70th. Can you believe?
Yeah.
And You know, the reunion was great, getting back to see your friends and getting back to the cult, get to feel young again. Every time you went up to Barnard, you'd come back all energized. At least I always did.
I do too.
Yeah.
I want to thank Marjorie for being with us today and for letting us hear about her experience and Barnard history. And we hope that we will see you at reunions in the future. Thank you so much.
My pleasure. And thank you very much for having me.